This unit is, I think, the most exciting of the 22 in the series. It's for you very much a relaxation from the slog of learning mineral names and learning how to classify igneous rocks and learning new geological jargon. It's a unit that deals with the big idea of geology, the unifying theory that represents to geology what evolution represents to biology. It's the theory of plate tectonics, the realization that the surface shell of the Earth is composed of a mosaic of plates, rather like the back of a tortoise shell. The big ideas of any branch of science are much more interesting and exciting to read about and to think about than the gathering of data. For example, if you're a biology student, then learning and reading about evolution is much more exciting than learning to gather the basic data of biology, classifying plants and animals. And for this reason, I'm quite sure that you will find this unit on plate tectonics much more exciting and stimulating to your curiosity than learning to classify igneous rocks. The advent of plate tectonics enabled us to explain many geological phenomena that you're familiar with that previously were not very well explained. Earthquakes and volcanoes are two very obvious examples. If ever there was a eureka moment in geology, it would be the moment when the first geologists recognized the boundaries of those plates, and suddenly a great many things fell into place, and many, many geological phenomena. So the first half hour of this hour is devoted to the Planet of Man program, the Jigsaw Fit, and then half an hour of more plate tectonics.
I previously had a total misconception about the Earth. The original idea of continental drift involved the continents moving around like ships in the oceans, through the oceans. But the new idea is that the surface of the Earth is divided into a series of plates, which are bigger than continents. We call this motion of these plates plate tectonics. And there are only about six of these major plates. And they each comprise ocean and land as well. And the motion of these plates relative to one another is where mountains are built, or where mid-ocean ridges form by the separation of these plates, or where plates slide past one another, as in the St. Andrews Fault in California.
Realms of eternal mystery. So they seemed to early man living in the long shadows of mountains. Here, where the land reached up into the heavens beyond the clouds, he could stand in the presence of his gods and ghosts, his demigods and demons. Here he could feel them gazing down upon him in silence from their icy thrones, or listen to them whispering their secrets to one another in the alien tongues of mountain winds. And in terror, he heard them at war, the land quaking with their anger, and rivers of fire boiling up from the depths of the earth to spew from gaping mouths of long silent volcanoes. Later generations of men, less pious, came to cross the mountains in search of wealth and the promise of a new life beyond. To them, they were barriers, everlasting obstacles that stood firmly between a dream and its fulfillment. Places less of mystery than of trial, adversity, and misery. And when finally man conquered the mountains and probed them with his sciences, he found nested in their secret places not gods, not demons, but the elements of a new mystery. Here, on the peaks of even the highest, 5 miles above the face of the land, he unearthed rocks that had once been formed beneath the seas, and learned that mountains too have a beginning, And more, he learned that the earthquakes and volcanism that from time to time shook the world around him were the sound not of gods at war, but of the earth itself being shaped. At first consideration, there seems little pattern to the distribution of mountains. They stand on most of the major continents of the world. The Andes of South America. The multiple ranges of Western North America. The mountains of the Western Pacific and Indonesia. And the great Himalayan Alpine belt stretching from China to Western Europe. When viewed from above, however, they are arranged in long, narrow belts running thousands of miles, suggesting that they are not random creations. In the past, many had observed that volcanic and earthquake activity was characteristic of mountainous regions, but the first observations were imprecise and of little value. However, in the early 1950s, the refinement of the seismograph made exact observation possible. For with this instrument, sensitive to the most minor disturbances in the earth, scientists were able accurately to locate the sources of earthquakes. These disturbances were traced to long, narrow belts. They coincided exactly with the continental mountain ranges and mountainous island arcs. More remarkable was the discovery that these narrow belts of earthquake activity ran off the continental margins and through the ocean basins, ultimately connecting the continental belts and dividing the world with continuous lines of earthquake activity. They also discovered that most of the active volcanoes are found along these earthquake belts. If, as the investigation had revealed, there was a direct relationship between the continental mountain ranges and the belts of earthquake and volcanic activity, scientists had then to fathom if a similar relationship applied to the belts that wound through the ocean basins. And fathom was precisely what was done. For with the development of sonar instruments, it was now possible to map the ocean floor. They discovered a system of huge ridges as large as the continental mountain ranges. And a series of very deep trenches. When the information was compiled, the discovery was made. The belts of earthquake and volcanic activity did indeed follow the mid-oceanic ridges and trenches. In the early 60s, a remarkable discovery here on the mid-Atlantic ridge provided an explanation for the undersea tremors and volcanism. The sea floor was actually fracturing and spreading. Further investigation brought yet another discovery. This gradual separation of the Earth's crust was occurring along all the mid-oceanic ridges. With the discovery of sea floor spreading, science now had an explanation for the disturbances along the oceanic ridge systems. But this still left unexplained the severe earthquakes and volcanism that from time to time shook the continental mountains. Ridges are spreading to either side of South America. The continent isn't getting smaller. Therefore, something must be happening to the ocean floor between the two ridges. It was proposed that the sea floor was descending beneath South America. This offered a plausible explanation for the severe earthquakes and volcanoes that plagued the Andes. So So the process of spreading, the creation of new seafloor, is balanced by destruction along trenches. Science now had a viable explanation for the disturbances along continental mountains. Over the last decade, the pieces of this remarkable puzzle have been isolated and examined, and recently have been fitted together into a coherent whole. The result is a revolutionary theory known as plate tectonics, a theory that yielded a solution to the enigma of mountains. The world is veined with narrow belts of activity. The inactive areas are immense plates, rigid slabs of the Earth's crust, approximately 60 miles thick. Sitting upon a number of them, appearing like protrusions, are the continental masses. These plates rest upon another layer of the Earth, which is far less rigid. Riding on this layer, the plates are actually floating. Absurd? Canada was once covered by a vast ice sheet. The weight of ice pressed the plate deep into the less rigid layer beneath. The ice melted, and ever since, the land has been slowly rising back to its normal position. On the shores of Hudson's Bay, the gradual rising is well illustrated by an indistinct shoreline and a series of raised beaches. At the moment, the world is composed of several major plates: the Indo-Australian, the Eurasian, the African, the American, the Antarctic, the Nazca, and the Pacific. These plates move about very slowly on the hot, mobile layer beneath. The only observable movement occurs along plate boundaries. This movement, a few inches a year, is small in terms of a human lifespan. But in geological time, it is the chief agent in shaping the surface of the Earth. Where two plates are separating at a ridge, material moves up from below to fill the space. Part of it melts to produce molten rock. Some of this molten rock is erupted as submarine volcanoes. Some of it re-solidifies beneath the surface. This rock, called basalt, forms the crust of the newly created plate. The unmelted material that doesn't reach surface forms the lower layer of the plate. It is a magnesium-rich rock called peridotite. In an underwater eruption, the molten lava comes in direct contact with the cold sea water. And forms characteristic pillow-like shapes. In a few places, this ridge system rises out of the sea. Material is hurled over half a mile into the air. Iceland itself stands right on the mid-Atlantic ridge. The island is a creation of the spreading process. It is composed entirely of the volcanic rock that welled up between the separating plates. On a geological hotspot with considerable volcanic activity, the people of Iceland have adapted to life on an active zone. Citizens of its capital city receive much of their water ready heated by the earth. In some places, the earth is so hot that bread can be baked by burying it in the soil. Since Iceland has a foot on both plates, the spreading rate can be accurately measured. An ocean is born when a continental mass is cut by a separating plate boundary. The mid-Atlantic ridge system traces a shape that closely corresponds with the two continental coastlines. If the ocean floor between the two were consumed, they would meet very neatly at the ridge. Calculations have shown that it's taken the better part of 200 million years to open to its present width. Since continents ride fixed on their plates, plate movements can be traced by examining the jigsaw fit of continents. The Red Sea, for example, a 125-mile-wide stretch of new ocean basin. With their similar coastlines, it's not difficult to imagine how Africa and Arabia once fitted together. East Africa's Great Rift Valley. Here we may be witnessing the early stages of this separation process. A strip of the continent several thousand miles long has subsided. The whole of the Rift Valley is characterized by volcanism. Here, at some remote future time, an ocean basin may develop. In the process of separation, plates can also slide past one another, creating what is called a transform fault. This form of movement produces little or no volcanism and no spectacular mountains, but the grinding opposition of the two plates causes intense earthquake activity. In most cases, these fault-created earthquakes occur in the deep ocean basins. But sometimes they cut the continents. The San Andreas Fault in California. Here, running 700 miles through the state and clearly evident to the eye, is the line that marks the meeting place of the American and Pacific plates. Equally as evident to those who live here is the threat that it poses to their existence, for the area has been hit with successive severe earthquakes as far back as man can remember. Movement occurs along most of the fault lines without incident. Unfortunately, there are stretches that catch, temporarily halting movement. In such areas, immense pressure builds up, and as the stress increases, so does the risk of severe earthquakes. The city of San Francisco, sitting directly on the fault line, paid dearly for its location in 1906, for in that year, the entire city was destroyed in a single momentous earthquake. 1971, there was another serious quake in the San Fernando Valley. Four people died, and damage was estimated in the millions. Scientists are convinced that another major earthquake will occur in the San Francisco area. The question is, when? The new skyscrapers are claimed to be earthquake-proof. But many doubt their ability to withstand a major quake. The spectacular mountain ranges that dominate the Earth are the result of plate movement. When two oceanic plates converge, one plate descends beneath the other. The point of contact is marked by a deep underwater trench. The descending plate is heated by friction and squeezed. It begins to melt. Although the oceanic crust is basaltic in composition, the molten rock produced here is granitic. Through the course of time, volcanoes are built up, granite warts on an oceanic crust. With successive eruptions, these cones eventually form strings of volcanic islands called island arcs. Japan is an island arc, formed over many tens of millions of years. Island arcs occur along the western margin of the Pacific Ocean. Violently eruptive from time to time, they form part of the ring of fire that surrounds the Pacific. Descending slab produces earthquakes of varying intensities. Japanese scientists have become expert in predicting the time and place of their occurrence. 15% of all earthquakes occur in the Japanese area. Similar volcanic and earthquake activity occurs with devastating results in the Andes, one of the greatest coastal mountain ranges in the world. This earthquake was responsible for the death of more than 50,000 people. Here, the oceanic plate descends directly under the continental margin. There are no island arcs. Molten rock rises through the continental crust. In time, volcanic mountain ranges are formed. The pressure created by the descending plate causes the land near the coast to fold up, deforming the rocks and pushing them even higher to form the jagged ranges of the Andes. Here, perched 3 miles high, the ruins of Machu Picchu, a city hewn from the Andes itself. Only this rock endures, a monument to a passing civilization. The Andes provide a clear illustration of the close relationship between converging plates and mountain building. The Rockies and other west coast ranges of North America were formed in a similar way. It's not difficult to imagine how the coastal mountain ranges came to be, but what about the inland Himalayas and Alps stretching from China to Western Europe? Well, if destruction of an ocean basin continues, the continents on the two sides must eventually come together, closing the basin. Since continents are granitic in composition, they float high on their respective plates. They resist the process of destruction characteristic of oceanic plates. Meeting head on, they collide, exerting immense pressures upon each other. Both the continental margins and the marine sediment in between are crumpled and deformed, throwing up a huge mountain range. This was how the great Himalayan mountains were created, also the Alps and the Pyrenees. All this came to pass long before man walked the earth and followed his gods and his dreams into the mountains. The mountains he, in the infinitesimally small span of his life, believed as permanent as his gods, as enduring as eternity. But what happens now? The future of man is perhaps less predictable than that of the earth itself. Two hundred million years ago, the earth was composed of one immense ocean and a single supercontinent, Pangaea. The continents to be have roughly their present-day shapes: Australia, Antarctica, India, Africa, Asia, North and South America. One hundred 35 million years ago, rifting has separated the supercontinent, and the fragments have started their long journey across the globe. Today we know the Mediterranean and the Pacific are getting smaller, the Atlantic and the Red Sea larger. And one thing remains certain: the Earth will change its shape again for man still unborn. The rest is speculation.
At first sight, it's very difficult to imagine the Earth being anything but a solid, massive, rocky sphere with fixed continents and permanent oceans on its surface. It's very difficult to imagine continents moving across the globe and colliding with one another, and also very difficult to imagine oceans coming and going every few hundred million years. And about 10, 15 years ago and beyond that, it was just as difficult for geologists to accept the mobility of the continents and the coming and going of the oceans, just as it is for you now. Geologists in North America, for example, were very skeptical when they read that their colleagues had suggested that the eastern seaboard of the United States, in fact, had once belonged to Africa and had become welded onto North America when Africa and North America had collided, and that subsequently they'd split apart and Africa had left part of itself, if you like, welded to North America. They were equally skeptical of the suggestion that the eastern part of Newfoundland had once belonged to Europe and that had become welded to North America in a similar fashion. The continent of Europe then having split away from North America again and leaving a remnant, now the eastern part of Newfoundland. Geologists in Europe were a little less skeptical than their colleagues in North America, but they too found it a little difficult to believe, for example, that the peak of the Matterhorn is part of Africa, while its base was suggested to be part of Europe. This mobility of the continents, the colliding and the separating and the coming and going of oceans, was once heresy, but now it's very much accepted as geological law, so to speak. The evidence for this theory of plate tectonics, as we call it, which is the basis for the mobility of the continents and the coming and going of the oceans, came from very many different areas, from paleontology, the study of fossils, from the study of the way that earthquake waves and seismic shock waves passed through the Earth, came from studies of rocks in the laboratory, the kinds of pressures that they could stand within the Earth, and so forth, the melting point of rocks. Very many areas. And all these similar areas have now received some sort of feedback from the new theory and have got, in a sense, a shot in the arm, if you like. It's become much easier for paleontologists to explain the distribution of fossils in the past, assuming that the continents were mobile and sometimes collided, sometimes split apart. When they collided, then they brought their now fossils, then living animals and plants, together. When they split apart, then the animals and plants were separated on sort of floating islands, if you like. The ice ages, for example, have also become somewhat more explicable when we understand how ocean currents probably changed as continents moved around on the globe. And one could go on through other areas of geology and point out the ramifications of this new theory to every facet of geology, but that would take a long time and it isn't really necessary, because we'll discover the importance of plate tectonics to all the aspects of geology as we go through the course. It's of fundamental importance to geology, just as it's important, as evolution is important, to biology. And this is the reason we've introduced it very early in the course. The rather fine film that you've just seen will have given you a much better picture in your mind than any book ever could do. The rather fine animation is better than we can certainly do, and you have a very, very good picture in your head already of just what's involved in plate tectonics. The purpose of the next half hour is not to duplicate what you've seen, but to elaborate a little on the structure of the plates, the rigid plates that move around on the surface, to look at the means by which it's been suggested that they move around, and to look at some present-day plate junctions, to have a look at our present globe and just see where the margins of the plates are and how they are behaving. The surface layers of the Earth are twofold. There is an upper rigid layer. We call this the lithosphere, and it's this layer from which the mosaic of plates is made. And then beneath that layer is a second layer we call the asthenosphere. Now, the behavior of these two layers is very different, and it's this which is fundamental to plate tectonics. The upper layer is rocky and rigid. It's this that we walk around on, and this upper pink patch represents a continent. the purple on either side represents the oceans. This layer, the yellow layer beneath, represents the asthenosphere. And the character of the asthenosphere is plasticity, if you like. That word sums up how the asthenosphere behaves. We believe, in fact, that the asthenosphere consists of about 10% of liquid and about 90% of crystals, and so is able to act as a kind of a lubricating layer over which the lithosphere can slide. The lithosphere underneath the continents is about 150 kilometers thick. It's difficult to be precise because the junction to the asthenosphere is not a sharp one. Beneath the oceans, it's perhaps 70 kilometers, the thickness of the lithosphere. And the asthenosphere is probably a little bit thicker underneath the continents than under the oceans. In total, the asthenosphere is probably about 100 kilometers thick, maybe a little more here and a little less there. So we've got a 100 kilometer thick sort of plastic layer over which the rocky plates, the solid, rigid rocky plates, can slide. The character of the asthenosphere is not just such as to allow the horizontal movements of plate tectonics, the horizontal movements of the rigid slabs on the surface, but is also very important in allowing vertical movements. And it's from this vertical movement the asthenosphere allows that we can best judge its character. For example, if you imagine an ice cap being placed, or growing, it's better said, on the top of the asthenosphere, then what happens is not really exactly what's happening in this plasticine model, but the asthenosphere flows out from the loaded area to the sides, to right and left beneath this model, and allows the ice cap to weigh down. Remember, the ice cap might be 1 or 2 miles thick. The present ice cap in Antarctica is at least a couple of miles thick. To weigh down on this mushy layer underneath, on the mushy asthenosphere, and that asthenosphere flows away. It comes up somewhere. Every time you press an area down with an ice cap, somewhere else on the Earth must rise a little. And if you remove the ice cap, melt it away, then the asthenosphere will flow back into place and the continent will rise again. We call this glacial rebound, and it's probably familiar to many of you who've done geography. The present area of northern Ontario is still rising and has risen quite considerably since the ice cap that was here melted away about 12 or 15,000 years ago. This is a very rapid geological process. The speed of the rebound is something in the order of, a centimeter, 2 centimeters, perhaps a century, perhaps even faster than that in some areas at the beginning of the rebound. That compares with mountain building, which is perhaps, a 50th of a millimeter in a year. Very, very thin indeed. The thickness of a playing card is much thicker than the rate of mountain building per year. This process of rebound we call isostatic rebound, as the asthenosphere flows back in under an area where there was once an ice cap loading the area down. So it's from that kind of reaction that we can measure on the Earth's surface that we first had some hint of just what the asthenosphere was like, some hint of its plasticity. Once we discovered that, then it was just a short jump to suspect that probably the asthenosphere allowed horizontal movements as well as vertical movements, the horizontal movements of the rigid plates of lithosphere. Let's have a look at the structure of the lithosphere before we pursue further the process of plate tectonics. The continental lithosphere, the continental rigid upper layer of the Earth, has a complex composition. The first 30, 40 kilometers or so, it varies from place to place. There's not a sharp and always defined thickness. The first 30 or 40 kilometers or so are formed of granite,
You've already seen granite in the program on igneous rocks, and all of you have certainly at one time walked over some granite, and you've certainly seen it in the front of banks and so forth. This is a chunk of granite, a pink one. The one in your rock kit is white, but granite, as you remember from the program on igneous rocks, varies according to the color of the feldspar. Sometimes it's pink, sometimes it's white. So that's what the upper 30 or 40 kilometers of the continental lithosphere look like, granitic in composition. The next layer, indicated here on green, or with green, about 40 kilometers down to 50, 55, thereabouts, is composed of gabbros. There is a piece of gabbro which you also ought to remember from your igneous rock kit, quite a common rock. And that forms then the lower part of, or the middle layer, if you like, toward the bottom of the continental lithosphere. This boundary here, marked by the two shades of green, which I hope that those of you with black and white sets can still see, is an important boundary in some respects. It's called the Mohorovicic discontinuity, or the MOHO for short, and we'll come across it again when we look at the way that the structure of the Earth has been interpreted using earthquake waves. And some of you have probably heard of Project MOHO, in which the geologists of the United States attempted to drill through to the Mohorovicic discontinuity beneath the oceans, oh, some years ago, perhaps 10 years ago now, a project which was abandoned. They never did get through. that layer then is gabbro. Beneath the Mohorovicic discontinuity is another rock, which is this. We think this is a rock eclogite, composed of garnets and pyroxene and olivine, a rock very rich in iron and magnesium, and a very heavy rock. As we've gone through the continental crust, in fact, we've gone from lighter rock to heavier rock. So the base of the continental lithosphere lies beneath the Mohorovicic discontinuity. This is the base of the lithosphere. That is where the so-called Mohorovicic discontinuity is. The structure then of the continental lithosphere is quite complex. The structure of the oceanic lithosphere is much simpler. let's set ourselves up with the structure of the continental lithosphere and then compare the oceanic lithosphere with it. This is the upper rock of the continental lithosphere, the granite. Beneath it, you'll remember the gabbro, and beneath that again, the eclogite. Those are then the three important rocks of the continental lithosphere. The oceanic lithosphere, on the other hand, although it begins with eclogite beneath the Mohorovicic discontinuity, has above it also gabbro, in the same way as the continental lithosphere, then is quite different. Above the gabbro in the oceanic lithosphere is basalt, which you remember is a lava. You saw that also in the program on igneous rocks. So there are two very contrasting kinds of lithosphere, oceanic and continental. The junction between the two types of lithospheric plate is rather complex. In this diagram, the oceanic lithosphere is here, the two layers of it, the top being the basalt in blue, and the lower, the black, being the gabbro. The continental lithosphere is just the same as you saw it on the earlier diagram. At the top here, the granitic part. Beneath that, the gabbro. And
here is the Mohorovicic discontinuity. This discontinuity marks the boundary between what we call the crust of the Earth, which is this bit of the oceanic lithosphere and this bit of the continental lithosphere, and this part which is the mantle. And the asthenosphere lies within the mantle at somewhere around about this level, if we were to distinguish it. So in this case, the continent lies within a lithospheric plate. And that kind of continental margin can be seen in North America, on the east coast of North America. The coastline of North America at present is not at the edge of the continent. In fact, the edge of the continent, or the coastline, 40,000 years ago, when sea level was much lower, was at the edge of what we call the continental shelf. The real boundary of the continent is at the bottom of the rather steep step that you see on the diagram. This steep, relatively steep step, which is not really as steep as it looks there, is the continental slope. And the real boundary of the North American continent lies at the bottom of that slope. This is where it joins the oceanic lithosphere. Now, in this case, as I mentioned, the continent sits within the lithospheric plate. And geologically, it's a pretty passive or inactive kind of place. There's not much exciting in terms of geology going on the east coast of North America. A contrasting kind of continental margin we find on the west coast of South America, where the Andes Mountains run down this coast here. And anyone who reads a newspaper knows about the earthquakes and the volcanic activity associated with the Andes Mountains in Chile and Peru and so forth. This is a cross-section of the Andes. This is South America, the continent of South America, sitting within a lithospheric plate. This is the lower boundary of the lithosphere. Here is the asthenosphere. So South America sits like a raft, if you like, within the lithospheric plate. This is a passive boundary, just like that which is on the east coast of North America, but the west coast, where the Andes Mountains are, here, is very different. At this point, there's a break between the oceanic lithosphere, which is there, and the continental lithosphere. This oceanic lithosphere is in fact moving down, physically moving down at a few centimeters per year beneath the lithospheric plate in which the continent of South America sits. And it's this descent of oceanic lithospheric plate, the grinding between the edges of two plates, which causes the earthquakes and the volcanoes. On a second diagram, you can see the same kind of situation, but slightly different, in the case of Japan. Now, on the map, that cross-section is up here at the western margin of the Pacific. Here is the arc of the Japanese islands, and here is the Asian mainland. Between the Japanese islands and the Asian mainland is a so-called Sea of Japan. And that is shown then on this cross-section. Here is the Pacific Ocean. This, in fact, is the west coast of North America. That's the oceanic lithospheric plate of the Pacific. Here it descends, and this is one of the island arcs, as we call them, of the Japanese island arc complex. There's a small piece of oceanic lithosphere trapped between this island arc and another island arc. It descends also, both of these then moving in this direction.
And the Asian mainland then lies over to the left of the diagram. Those points where oceanic lithosphere dives down beneath either continental lithosphere, as in the case of Western South America, or dives down beneath another piece of oceanic lithosphere, we call subduction zones, and we can show that process quite nicely on this this model. Imagine that this is then one piece of oceanic lithosphere, one piece of ocean, as it were. This is then another piece of oceanic lithosphere, and the subduction zone is where my finger is here. The actual movement is a real sheer physical movement at the rate of 3, 4, 5, 6 centimeters a year down beneath the other piece of oceanic lithosphere. The volcanoes which form the island arc build themselves up on this this side of the plate, which is being underridden. And that's quite nicely shown in this diagram here. Here is the descending oceanic plate, such as the Pacific plate, as it goes down beneath Japan. And as the plate descends, in a fashion that we shall discuss when we look at oceans and at volcanoes, melting takes place, and volcanic material rises, as you can see in red there, and builds up a marine volcano, if you like. The volcano rests on the floor of the piece of oceanic lithosphere, which is riding over the descending lithosphere, which forms the subduction zone. And there's a whole string of rather nice volcanoes on that diagram. Now, at the same time as lithosphere, oceanic lithosphere, is being destroyed by descending down a subduction zone, oceanic lithosphere must also be created. We obviously can't destroy down a subduction zone more than is created, because the Earth would have to get smaller. So the center of the oceans, where the spreading ridges are, is the place where oceanic lithosphere is created. Let's look in detail how that happens. This is the simplified as the situation. We have splitting in the center of the oceans between the margins of two plates moving apart like that. This is rather difficult to envisage, but look at this diagram here and see if we can make it a little clearer. This is the splitting point. This piece of oceanic lithospheric plate is going in that direction, and this piece in the opposite direction. And the plates grow to compensate for the destruction down subduction zones by the injection of a dike in the center. You can see the central one is a red line. And each dike, if you simplify it, can be imagined as splitting the previous dike. And so we have matched colors on either side of the splitting center here, each representing a dike split in half by a later intrusion. Now, it's obviously a little bit more complex than that, but that, roughly speaking, is what happens. There are lava flows on the surface here, and sediments gradually accumulate as the lithosphere moves to the side from the splitting ridge. Now, let's look at another series of diagrams. This one, you remember, was a Japanese situation. This is another situation in the Japanese, or the area of Japan. There's a subduction zone building up an island arc. And in here, there's a little piece of continent, a little piece of continental lithosphere trapped in the middle of what we would call a small ocean basin, because this is oceanic lithosphere on either side. And here is the Asian mainland. In another present-day situation that's familiar to all of us, this is the Himalayas. This is the continent of India, which rammed against Asia. There is the remnant of the ocean which once lay between Asia and India, and which gradually disappeared down a subduction zone until the two continents collided. Granite is too light to sink down an a subduction zone because its density is about 2.7 grams per cubic centimeter. A little sugar cube would weigh 2.7 grams, whereas the density of the material in which it would have to descend is about 2.9 or 3 or 3.4 even grams per cubic centimeter. And just like you can't sink a log of wood in water, neither can you sink granite back down a subduction zone. Behind India is the beginning of another subduction zone, because remember, the subduction zone in front of India was destroyed. Another one is beginning to be created here in order to balance the loss of a point where oceanic lithosphere was being destroyed originally in front of India. So this is a balance for the Himalayas, if you like. And then finally to Europe, which is quite a complex situation. This is the continent of Africa, sitting like a raft in the lithospheric plate of the Mediterranean, which is getting smaller. Africa is approaching the northern shore of the Mediterranean. This is Turkey, which is wedged between the now decreasing ocean of the Mediterranean and the decreasing ocean of the Black Sea, which very few people think of as an ocean. But geologically, the Black Sea is a remnant of an ocean. And so Africa is approaching Europe. Turkey is wedged between these two major pieces of lithosphere. And Turkey will eventually be rammed up against Europe and become a wedge between Africa and Europe. Down the center of Turkey is what we call a transform fault, some of which you saw in the film. And this is a point where lateral movement, sideways movement, is taking place. and this is the site of very much of the earthquake activity, the disruption in Turkey, along what we call the Anatolian Fault. Now, we'll follow up plate tectonics throughout the course, and we'll see many instances where plate tectonics is important. We'll look at it when we discuss ice ages. We'll look at it when we discuss fossils. Plate tectonics is, in fact, the very bulwark of geology at the present day.
There's still time to enroll in TV Ontario's fascinating geology series, Understanding the Earth. For a registration fee of $48, you'll receive a learning package which includes a viewer's guide and an extensive text called Physical Geology. In Toronto, call 967-3891. Outside Toronto, call toll-free 1-800-268-1121. Visa and MasterCard are accepted. This is TV Ontario, Channel 19 in Toronto.